I needed that too, my God. What a metaphor to start this afternoon session with, because batteries changed at this time. I'm sure you all need them too. Hopefully I can rev you up, probably not as much as Lyndall, but I'll do my best. I think she's a hard act to follow. Now, you've probably not heard of OVO. It's a, oh, wait a minute. You've got, wait, they're asking me to wait. Fill time. Lyndall, where did you get your jacket? I need that for my next.
I never tell where I am, I think.
Thanks for your help, Lyndall. Really helpful. Well, I'll tell you a little bit about OVO while we wait for, oh, they're here. It's an early stage startup. You've probably not heard of it because of that reason. It's only 2 years old. There's about 15 people in it. And, oh, look, they haven't got it in present of you. Guys, I need my notes because, again, Lyndall had hers printed out and I didn't, so I'm really well prepared. So let's go back. So OVO is an Australian startup, and what I'm going to tell you about today is why it came about. It was conceived as the first media telco in Australia. And I'm going to tell you about some really exciting tech that we're doing. Before that, you're probably wondering why is a media telco a good thing? I certainly did when I first heard about it. But there are some sort of mega trends behind why telcos are becoming media broadcasters, and I'll take you through them. The first one is mobile video. Stats are saying that it's growing exponentially, and it's at 60% of all digital video views at the moment in APAC. Other sources saying it's 80% globally. But I think whatever the stats are saying, we can safely say it's one of the primary screens that, well, it is the primary screen that consumers are now using to look at video. The second trend is the rise of content over the internet, which is commonly called OTT. In the US, OTT has already surpassed cable providers, with Netflix now, I think, at about 130, probably more, million subscribers globally. The third trend is surrounding telcos. Now, telcos are an interesting beast because Netflix wouldn't exist without telcos. So telcos have traditionally sort of sat back with their locked-in, high-margin customer base and spent billions on infrastructure while entrepreneurial companies quietly came along and made a truckload of money off their networks. So telcos luckily kind of woke up to this, but they also realised they were sitting on a gold mine with first-party data, network connectivity they didn't have to pay for, and device and billing expertise. So it stands to reason that they thought they'd try their hand at broadcasting as well. And what we've seen is that Morgan Stanley has said that OTT is now mainstream and is disrupting this whole structure of media, the whole media industry now. And you see that with the mergers that are taking place overseas. So our founder comes from a telco background. He spent a year in one of the large telcos. They're not any of the ones on this screen here, luckily. And he realised that they were really quite bad at media broadcasting. And so he had a major ambition to do it better. And that is how OVO was conceived. It was our version of what a media telco should be. And I thought I would just share with you a quick video on what we've achieved in 18 months.
Now, the only mobile plan specifically geared for kids. It's just been released by a telco called OVO.
And it's now available from OVO.
And I'm here with Matt Jones, the CEO of OVO Mobile. Matt, tell us a little bit about OVO.
If you're a fan, we get coverage in every single track around Australia.
Thank you.
able to distribute their live broadcast so that the fans of esports have unlimited data-free access to this amazing content.
Nice one signing up to OVO.
But to be successful, anyone who's worked in telco will know that it's a pretty competitive space. And so we had to not only innovate in the way that we bring products to market in the telco space, because that is extremely price-driven and very hard to compete in. We had to disrupt on the media side of the business. And so we went on a journey to look at how other OTT players had built their businesses and what assumptions were there to see if there was any opportunity to disrupt. The first assumption that underpins all of OTT as I see it is choice equals happiness. Now, I think all of us in Australia can say that we were pretty excited when Netflix launched. The choice that it gave us, we hadn't had it before. Foxtel was the nearest thing, and it was not very great unless you were a sports lover. So we assume that more choice equals more happiness. And look, initially it does, but studies have shown that once it gets to a certain point, that happiness disappears pretty quickly. We get completely overwhelmed and we reverse out of a situation and we won't make any choice at all. I've definitely had this experience when I've been looking for content online, and I think it's even more key with mobile apps because it's on the small screen, you're usually multitasking, so it's even more important to be relevant and cut through to keep those people from closing your app and, you know, God forbid, never opening it again. This is the choices that you see on the two biggest OTT platforms in the world, Netflix and YouTube. Netflix goes 11 times down and 6 times across. So I counted them, it was really fun. YouTube was even worse. I didn't know if I would ever find the bottom. And I think, you know, wading through these interfaces is not that fun anymore. I think the novelty is starting to wear off. The second assumption is control equals more, even more happiness. And look, certainly being able to watch when you want what you want to watch is really important. There's another side to human nature though, and another product did something completely opposite. And arguably the best algorithm in the world did was take control away from the user. So Pandora, I used to work there, so I am a little bit biased, but they spent 100 years of hours studying music, categorizing the 2 million songs so that the algorithm could make a better choice than the consumer. And I think for me, I used to use it, and I've got some evidence to show, it's anecdotal of course, that people just loved it. They loved not having the control just because it was done so well. And look, Spotify is bigger, especially in Australia because it launched here first, and Pandora's not here anymore, which makes me very, very sad. But what is not well known in Australia is that despite Pandora being in only 3 countries and Spotify being in 55, Pandora still had more listeners in 2016. And I think the listening time on Pandora is about triple that of Spotify just because of that user experience. And so even now with Pandora in 1 country and Spotify in 65, the time spent on the platform is probably equal, which is pretty amazing and shows the power of, you know, an algorithm that takes control away from users. This is what happened when Pandora left the country. And you can see everyone understood what it was doing. And I think the one that I like the best is, thank you for introducing me to some amazing artists I may not have stumbled across on my own. Music streaming will never be the same. So there was a lot of happiness generated from this out of control kind of algorithm. The third and related assumption that OTT players make is that any old algorithm is going to generate bamboozled delirium in consumers. And I've got some examples to show you what I mean. So Netflix. I said before I love Netflix, and I do. I've been a Netflix user since about 2014. There are major benefits from working for an American company. You have to have a VPN on your computer, so I couldn't help but be illegal. So Netflix knows me. They know that I watch quite a lot of dark detective stories, as you can see here, with a smattering of romantic comedies. But Netflix said to me when I asked them recently what I should watch, they said, you should watch Top Picks for Nicole, Gilmore Girls, How I Met Your Mother, and Full House. So I thought long and hard about sharing this because I was pretty embarrassed. And I'm sure there's people in the room that think, she's got a little guilty pleasure in Full House or Gilmore Girls. I promise you I don't. And I mean, the proof is in my history. But obviously, somewhere in the Netflix algorithm, my age and my gender have been pushed to the top of that decision tree, and I get this crap, and then I have to go searching and wasting my time. It's really suboptimal. I work full time, I've got two kids, I don't have time to be delivered stuff that is completely not for me. And I feel like Netflix could do a little bit better. I mentioned Spotify, biggest music streaming platform in the world now. I tried Spotify after Pandora left. I needed another music streaming platform in Australia. And I had these high hopes that they've been, you know, because they followed Pandora, that they would have been stealing the algorithm from them over time. So I left Spotify to its own devices, and this is what happened. For it. How's that for a customer experience? Like, wow. Does anyone know what the algorithm did there? It's a bit of a music trivia question for you. Any music aficionados who can guess? No? Okay, that abomination was the algorithm going alphabetical on song title. And so it went from Venture or Highway by America to Venus by Bananarama. Now look, I love Venus at a wedding when I'm drunk, but when I was in the car after having the chance to have seen America, listening to Venture or Highway, it was the last thing I wanted to listen to, and I was not very happy. Not very happy that Pandora wasn't here, and then even unhappier that there was not a good substitute with Spotify. So, the algorithms exist, but they're not in a great state yet. They're in a pretty bad state. How the assumptions kind of play out, therefore, in a consumer's life is that there's a whole set of expectations that these guys think are going to happen because, I mean, the hard work for them has been getting the content to us. And so this sort of next phase hasn't happened yet. So they expect that we're going to open their app, know exactly what they want, what we want when we open it, or have plenty of time to just faff around wading through stuff looking for what we do enjoy. And I think it's because of that excitement that we still have, that we have the choice and control, We're still in that phase where we'll put up with these bad consumer experiences because the choice is still bedazzling to us. And you know, I'm definitely amongst that. And I'm not saying that these companies have done anything wrong, because it's actually made our lives so much better. But I think there's just opportunity now to take it to that next level and to understand what makes humans genuinely happy, not just these first stage excitement. And I think the biggest miss here, I mean, what presentation is not complete without a Steve Jobs quote? Like, seriously. No, I apologise. I don't want to be that hackneyed, but this is a good one, and I do believe it. I think that innovation comes when we discover it, not when we tell companies what we want. We don't know what we want, but we love to discover it, and we love to have it revealed to us. So the thing about discovery, rather than having to go and wade through things and find things that we like, having things revealed to us and makes us feel amazing in the moment. Like, it gives us that bit of joy where we've saved some time, or it just makes us happy. But then we go and tell our friends and share with them this discovery that we've made in a product, a service, or a piece of content. And they are happy as well. And so it sort of has this roll-on effect of you becoming a bit of a social hero, making other people happy as well, and being happy yourself. So I think that discovery is kind of this last bastion of brand love. And I know it's probably a little bit idealistic to say. We've talked a lot about how brands aren't loved anymore, and most of the time they're hated. But if you can give something to customers in these moments when they want them, that is the closest you're going to get, I think. So it's extremely powerful. Luckily for us, we shared a major investor with a company called Incoming Media, and they felt exactly the same way about discovery as we did. So they were working on AI and ML content delivery and really making it more relevant and satisfying for consumers. And in 2017, we merged with them because we had the content and they had the tech. So now what we're doing with them is working on not only on our first party data and looking at consumer behavior the way Netflix does, and then surfacing content that suits them and relevant to them. We're looking for moments when they actually want to consume content. We do that through looking at the phone's sensors and the phone's data. This is where it gets really creepy, but good. But what we do is we can see the mood state of a person by what they're doing with their phone. And the phone gives you information like, you can make assumptions of it. If a phone is speeding along at 60 kilometres an hour at a 45 degree angle with the headphone jack in, the person is likely to be commuting and looking at their phone, not driving, not at work, not distracted. And if they've just opened four apps in the last 30 seconds, they're likely to be really bored and really, really media receptive at that moment. And so what we're doing now is using that data to surface content when they're actually wanted. We download the content in a Wi-Fi environment so it doesn't cost any data for them. And then we wait for the moment when they actually want content and surface it to them at that time. We can tell where they are, we can tell when they're ready for content, and we can also tell all sorts of other creepy things about them from their phone. But we don't use it for any other reason than to surface content to them when they want it. So we're making their life better. And the second great thing about this is that no action is required. So the customer doesn't have to do anything, and they can easily reject this. So there's not a lot of cognitive load, there's not a lot of intrusion, because they just open their phone and it sits there like a notification, like you already get a lot of text notifications on your phone. It's a video notification though, so it's a little bit more eye-catching. And then it deep links straight into the app if you click on it. So it's a great user experience that doesn't cost the user anything. This was tested in the US on advertising, not on content. And it was tested with about 5 million users. I think the company, because it was like an incubator company, it came out of the CSIRO and was working with Google in the States. I think they naively, and they're engineers and PhDs and data scientists. So they used some advertising without asking for permission. So it was fantastic, but they got their results. I think they got sued, I'm not sure. that was before we merged with them, thank God. But the great thing is the results were amazing. So just having a video notification instead of a text notification increased the click-through rate by 3 times. And having that perfect timing, that perfect moment when you actually want to see content, increased it by 7 times. So it's actually phenomenal. We're building this at the moment, but I'm excited to say I think it'll be live on our app within weeks, probably the next couple of weeks. I got sent a sample last night. It was too late to include it in this presentation, but I would download the app soon because it's coming and you can experience for yourself. So the great thing is that we at OVO don't expect much from our customers. And I think it's a good place to be because customers are really busy and they are living their lives and they're not thinking about our brands. They're not thinking about, our challenges on a day-to-day basis nor how we compare with our competitors. They're just looking for brands that will make their life a little bit better in any given moment. And so we don't expect much from them. We just want to deliver what they need when they want it. And that's all we hope for, and I hope that consumers love it as a result. This is just our vision and our goals and some of the sports and content that we have on the platform. But Derek said that I had to keep it to 20. I'm all right, I'm getting the thumbs up. 2 minutes, how good is that? But in the meantime, just download the app, have a play. We're going to do the hard work for you and just sit back and relax and enjoy the content. Thank you.